Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. All right, so let's do a quick recap of what we've done so far on this project. It's really, really simple, and we'll kind of hit a couple of the details on this also. But before we go any further, of course, we want to remember that we took two sheets of plywood and we've already ripped them down and cross-cut them to, well, basically the dimensions we have here. We still have some more pieces that are kind of off to the side that are in a rough state, but we'll be getting to those pretty soon. The main thing I wanted to do was I wanted to get the top, the two sides, the bottom, and then the vertical divider cut to the dimensions that I want so I can really kind of get things started. Because once I get those in place, everything else is just going to fall together. Now, of course, we saw that we used the track saw to pretty much do the majority of the cross cutting and a little bit of the ripping. And the neat thing with the track saw, and I could do this with my table saw, but you know what? Sometimes these pieces are just a little bit bigger and unwieldy than I would like them to be for using on the table saw. So using the track saw, I came in and I cut these 45 degree miters here, which allowed the top and the side to come together, and it's going to make a really beautiful joint. In fact, one thing I did when I was trying to put this together was I wanted to have a side and the top so that it was almost like one flowing grain pattern all the way across. It would almost look as if we took one really long board and were able to cut that. So with a little careful planning, that's what we ended up getting, and I think it's going to turn out fantastic. Now, obviously, once we got those miters cut, those bevels, we came in with our biscuit joiner and we biscuit it so that these will come together, and it's going to give it a lot of gluing surface. But I'm not going to simply rely on those to keep this thing together. I actually have some pieces I'm going to put in here that will act as glue supports, glue blocks basically, to help tie that in, and they'll be out of the way. Nobody will ever see those except if you pull out the drawers and take a look at them. Now, one more thing we did for the bottom to tie it in with the sides, of course, we created these quarter inch deep by quarter inch wide dados that then take a quarter inch tongue from the bottom. They fit in there, and that helps to add even more support and strength to it so that when there's going to be moving around, it's not going to rack, it's not going to fall apart. We really have a lot of glue surface in here and supporting joints that are going to keep it nice and tight. One more thing that's going to really help out is rather than putting in a quarter inch panel in the back, which really would work out perfectly fine for this, I've decided I have enough plywood that I'm going to put a full 3/4 inch plywood back for the back itself. Now, some of you might be saying, well, that's really overkill. Some of you might be thinking, well, I would have done the same thing because it only makes sense. And it does. I mean, it's going to really give a lot of extra rigidity in there. And that's really one thing I'm really looking for when it comes to this particular project. This is one that's going to see a lot of traffic, a lot of wear and tear. So I want to make sure that it's as strong as ever. And it's going to add a little extra weight, but it's not going to be unbearably heavy. So what we need to do next is we have a vertical divider, which we're going to put in here, which is going to define two drawers and two sets of doors. Again, I'm going to use biscuit joints to get everything lined up. This isn't so much a structural piece. I mean, it kind of is, but it's not one that is going to make or break the piece, to be quite honest with you. Once we get that back tied in there, I'm really not too worried about the vertical divider, where, you know, taking a lot of beating or anything, but it's important still to get it lined up so that it's nice and square, so that the doors will be square, and so the drawers will be square. So that's going to be one of our next things that we need to do. Also, I decided that we're going to end up putting a solid wood banding here on the front. We could have gone with just the simple veneer, but I really like the look and the feel of solid wood, and it makes me feel more comfortable that it's going to last much longer than a simple veneer. Again, this piece is going to be getting a lot of traffic on it, so therefore we want to make sure it's going to last. And we're not just going to simply be putting a solid wood banding on the front here. We're also going to be putting it around the drawers, around all the dividers, and around each one of the doors. And to help us make sure that we get this on there, we could simply do a basic butt joint when it comes down to it. Just simply glue the strips right onto the material. But instead, what we're going to use is a great bit, and I'll explain more about this in a minute, from the folks over at Eagle America, which allows us to make two mating pieces. We have a female piece that would cut here into the surface, and like I said, I'll explain this. We'll head over to the router table and take a look at it, and in just a little bit. But essentially, what ends up happening is it creates a groove along the whole entire length of the surface that you're cutting, the edge that you're cutting, and it also creates a V in there too, which then you just put in a second router bit, which has the corresponding male portion, which creates a nice little spline that fits in there, and then you have the solid wood material. And the nice thing about this is it gives you a couple of different options. You can make that material so that it's so thin, it fits right on here. You don't even notice that there's any solid wood material. In fact, it gives the plywood the look itself like it is solid wood. Or if you want to have it just a little bit thicker and, you know, definitely show that it is a separate piece, maybe you're using a contrasting wood or something, you could have it stick out a little bit thicker. The neat thing about this is it gives you those options to make it really thin or really thick, but more importantly, it gives you a lot of glue surface so you don't have to worry about it going anywhere, and it's going to look absolutely fantastic. So what we need to do next is we have one little error on here that I discovered when we were doing our rough glue up here. In fact, it's not glued up yet. It's just our rough finning, our dry fit. I accidentally discovered that this piece down here, this particular side, unlike everything else, turns out that here at the top, it's actually about an eighth of an inch wider than the bottom. And that was a kind of a relief thing, because when I was putting the whole thing together, and I'm like, oh, why is this not coming together? It's not square. This is out of place. Well, apparently when we were cutting it on the table saw, we ended up actually kind of apparently twisting just a little bit, and that created that gap. This is one of the reasons why doing a dry fit ahead of all your gluing up will really, really save your butt. Because if I had glued this up and not made that discovery, man, I don't even want to think about it. So what we're going to do is we have to take this apart. We'll take that one off. We'll recut it, get it to the width that we want. And then we're going to head over to the router table where we'll put that mating joint on there. And then we'll have a fresh one ready to go. And it's going to work out, you know, exactly the way we want it to. Keep our fingers crossed on that. So we're going to do that next. And then the other thing that we need to do is, like I said, we need to put this vertical divider in place. And we'll go from there. So I'll see everybody over at the table saw.
And thankfully, this was just a quick fix. Set the fence, remove the material, and we're back in business. And now that we have a fresh edge cut, it's time to redo the V-groove that we originally routed on this piece. Routing with these specialized bits is really easy, that is, once you get them set up properly. Using a profile set like these, it's very important to make a few test cuts to make sure you have them exactly at the right height and depth that you need. But once you do, it doesn't take much time at all to get the profile cut in your stock. Let's come back and we'll talk a little bit more about these at the end of today's show.
Since the majority of the wear and tear is going to be right at the front of it, I was thinking I want a little bit more beefier edge than what we would normally have with the surrounding solid pieces that I'm going to put in. So I kind of molded over a little bit, and I'm like, I could make that mating piece really, really thick, or I could just simply take a much wider piece and mate it right to the bottom. And that's what I'm going to end up doing. My main reason for this is, like I said, this is going to get quite a bit of wear and tear, because this is where you have two sets of doors opening and closing. Things are going to be going out in and out of there. People will be kind of kicking it by accident. You know, I don't think they're going to be doing it on purpose. Who knows? Maybe they will. But I want to make sure that the veneer from the plywood isn't going to be tearing off in this area. I want to have quite a bit of wear strip is what it really comes down to. So I have this solid piece of walnut, and I cut it to the same size of the bottom. And what I need to do now is, before I actually connect it to the rest of the bottom, and I'm going to use biscuits to do it along with the regular glue line in there, it'll give it a nice really tight fit once I get that divider in there, because it's going to attach in here. That will be a second point that will help to hold it in place. And then we're going to, of course, make those little rabbets at the end here so that they'll fit into the sides, again giving it one more point that will help to really strengthen it up. So we've got it cut to length. Now we need to measure out and mark for those rabbets. And it's really simple. Again, I'm going to kind of grab my multi-mark here, and I'm just going to go right off of the existing rabbets that I have. So I'll just go right over here and I'll loosen this up, put it in place. You can just do this with a regular square, and that will give me my first marking that I need, which will determine the depth of the rabbet. So I'll just come right over here to the solid piece, and I'll just kind of lay out this mark here. Oops. Lay it out. Okay, so I get my pencil line, flip it over. We're going to do the same exact thing on this end. Again, it's just in place. I'm just going to set the pencil right up against the blade. Follow it along. I've got my measurement there for the depth of the rabbet. Now I need to know the height of the rabbet. Again, we'll just take the multi-mark. We'll loosen it up, lift the blade up till it makes contact, tighten the knurled knob, and now I have the height. So I know this is the bottom side of my walnut. The main reason I know that is because here at the top, you can obviously see that's a little sapwood, and I can hide it this way without having to worry about it. So let's go ahead and we'll just set this like this. Again, I know this is the bottom. I'm just going to make one or two marks, and then we'll kind of connect the dots here. There, there's that one. Let's do it over here on this side. Like I said, we'll just kind of, we'll make a couple of them so that we can just come back in with a straight edge. And like I said, connect those dots. And then all we need to do now is, once we connect those dots, we have our reference lines. We can remove that material. And then this solid piece is ready to attach to the bottom. And we're that much closer towards the final assembly.
And once we have the tongues cut on either end, it's time to cut the biscuit slots in the solid wood and also in the plywood so we can glue them together to make one wide bottom piece.
As you saw in today's project, I ended up taking the side over to the router table and routing on one of the profiles from this two-piece edge banding set that I got from Eagle America. Now the main purpose for this, it wasn't just the one side, I did it on both sides of the top. Also on the vertical divider and on the drawer dividers, as we'll see those coming up pretty soon. The main purpose for it was I wanted to have something that added a little more rigidity to the face frame I was going to attach than just simply gluing it in place. Now, if the face frame had been a little bit wider rather than just being the thickness of the plywood, I probably would have used maybe another mechanical fastener such as like a pocket hole joint, or even I might have used a biscuit to help hold it in place. But instead, I wanted to try this type of edge banding system that they have. Now, typical edge banding is more or less you just take a piece of stock, much like this, which is the thickness of the material you're working with. You would cut a thin strip off of it, maybe about up to a quarter of an inch at the absolute most. Anything less than that, well, you could do that too, because you could just use a veneer strip, and then you would glue it in place. Now, one problem with that is that on a long stretch, such as the top, it could start getting a little wavering in there if you're not careful with the glue up. By using a set of router bits like this, one has a tongue that will go into it, and that's the part that you saw me cutting in the video itself. And what it does is it creates a V groove with a tongue inside there, so that, or actually more of a groove, so that it acts like a spline to help align and also give you more glue surface for that edge banding to stay in place. And then this is the mating router bit, which then cuts the profile that would fit into there. And I happen to have those profiles right here. We'll get a close-up on it. This is the profile that is cut by the mating piece here, by the female portion, which cuts the V, and then also the spline that will fit into the groove. And then this portion, which is more the male portion, cuts the V groove and the spline at the same time. Now, the main thing with these router bits is they can be a little tricky to set up at first. So rather than getting really frustrated and of course messing up our main stock, what we're gonna do is we would head over to the router table and we would do a couple of test cuts just to make sure that we got it right. So let's do that right now. Let's come over here. I'll show you how I end up getting mine set to go so that I have to do less fussing at the router table with my test cuts and getting right into the cuts themselves. All right, so we're over at the router table and we're about to set up the first of the two pieces. And the way that Eagle America recommends doing it is that you would set it into your router table, you get your raised up to the appropriate height, and then you mark the center of the stock that you're going to be working with, and then it's a matter of course, making sure that your router is unplugged. It's then just a matter of raising the router up enough so that the center of this male portion here would be centered on this. And that's a pretty good way to go. But one thing I like to do is, and again, you need to be extra cautious because these bits are very, very sharp. If possible, and I'm doing this with my test material, because remember we're going to do a couple of test cuts before we ever get to our main material. I just take this and I line it up to make sure that these two chamfer edges here are going to be cutting right into my material at the top and the bottom. And then I just simply mark where they go. So that gives me my reference. It's not going to be my final set part. So we'll go ahead and we'll drop this into the router table. We'll get this all set up. Okay, so it's not going to go anywhere. Get everything ready to go. Let's go ahead and move the camera down so that we can see this. We'll zoom in a little bit so we get a better idea. All right, and then we're going to bring the table forward again, making sure that the router is unplugged. Let me get my fence locked down here. And at this point, if you can see it right in there, I think we've got it lined up pretty good. Let's see. There we go. That's a little bit high, so let's go ahead and lower this just a little. Let's come down. And that's almost right on my marks. Come down just a little bit more. Not too much. Okay, there we go. Now that's about lined up where I want it. And one thing with this bit, you can go in a little bit more and you're going to remove a lot of material. But the idea is that we don't want to shave away here. We want the bit to come right up to the very edge. So I will just move my fence back and forth until I see that it looks like it's just about there. I think that's a good place to stop. We'll go ahead, make our first pass, and then we'll check to see if it's exactly where we want it. So we'll do that right now. So we'll go ahead and make that first pass. All right, well, we got really lucky with that setup for the first router bit. It's exactly centered, or at least close to center as we need it to be. Because it's plywood, you know, it's gonna be a little bit thinner, so we can make up for that with our solid stock. But really, when it comes down to it, it's exactly where we need it. If it's off a little, it's not that bad. One thing I would recommend is when you're playing with the router fence, you might want to have a little bit shallower pass to get started, because then you can always adjust it. If you have too much, obviously you can't put the material back on. So if start with a shallow pass, have the router fence set in a little bit, and you'll notice, because it will create a small shoulder. I don't know if you can see that very well, but this was another pass that I had done much earlier on than today, in which we do have a slight shoulder created. So what this really meant was, number one, the fence wasn't in the right position, so I needed to push it back a little, and then that's how we would end up getting to this. Test cuts are very, very crucial to making sure that we don't waste stock and that we get it exactly the way we want it. Now, with that set up the right way, at this point I would run my materials through so that I get this nice female joint that I have here with the nice groove in there, and then the V shoulders that will accept the next portion, which is going to come from this router bit. So in order to get this set up, the way that they recommend it is that we would take our material that we're going to use as our edge banding, and rather than taking that first bit out, what we're going to do is we're going to use that first bit to help us get the height set for this as a reference, so that it will go that much faster with getting the second bit done. So let's go ahead, and I'm going to bring the camera over here so you can get a better idea of what we're going to be doing down at the router table. Okay, again, before we get started, we make sure that the router is unplugged so we don't have any mishaps. We just will simply butt the stock up against the router bit itself. And what I like to do is just draw a reference pencil line, at least from the top. If you can get it from the bottom, that's fantastic. That gives us something that we can refer to on the next router bit. So we're just going to go ahead and remove this one, and we'll put the new one in. Okay, so I have the new one in, and then I'm just going to take that reference line that I have, And I don't know if you can see it very well. Maybe we can zoom in just a little bit more on it. There we go. And so we have that nice reference line. And as I can see, it looks like the bit is just a pinch too low. So I'm going to raise it up just a little bit. And it looks like it should be removing the material exactly where we want it. So we'll now move the fence into position. And that little notch in the back, that's where I want my edge to line up. So let me go ahead and lock this down first, this half. There. And I can just see that that's right about where I want it. I'll go ahead, I'll make my first pass, and then we'll test fit it and see if it's exactly where we want it. And if necessary, we'll raise or lower this to make those adjustments. All right, well, luckily, I think a lot of it has to do with experience. We got this all set up exactly where we wanted on the first try. So at this point, I would just go ahead and I would run my material through. And then once I have that, I'm gonna move myself over to the table saw. And at this point, we have to decide how thick we want that edge banding. And what I did was, well, once we made a couple of passes on this material, I took one edge banding rather thin and one kind of thick. And let's take a look at the difference of those on the material. So again, here we have our mating piece. This is the first one. And then we have our examples from the second piece. And as you can see, there's that nice spline on there, or the groove, the tongue, whatever you want to call it. And then they just simply just fit right into place, provide you a lot of gluing surface so that you don't have to ever worry about this edge banding coming apart. And you can get them so that they'll butt right up against that surface. It looks like all one uniform piece. Of course, in this situation, we're using a contrasting wood just to kind of give you a better idea of what it's going to look like. As you can see, there's the end as it's fitting right in there. Here's a thicker version and a thinner. As you can see, exactly what they look like. It's your choice how thick or thin you want to go with it. One thing I will say is, even with careful setup over there, you might notice that one edge is a little bit more proud than the other, or both of them are slightly proud. That's not really an issue, because what you can then do is come in with like a card scraper or even like a block plane and then a card scraper or sandpaper. Knock that edge down so it's nice and flush with the other one. And then again, this gives you even tighter joint. It will look really, really nice. And if you're using the same type of material, you can make your plywood look very much like a solid. So it's a great router bit set. The other one's still over there, but it's a two-piece set and they work fantastic. And once you get the setup, what you can end up doing is hold on to those test blocks that you have and just use them as a reference every single time. Your setups will go twice as fast and you'll be able to take care of business. Definitely worth the money. Thanks to the folks over at Eagle America for letting us try these out.
To find the show notes and links mentioned in today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. There you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show and our monthly swag drawings and more. And while you're there, please consider helping to support the show by visiting our various advertisers and sponsors. By clicking on the links and making purchases, you not only have a chance to buy great tools and services for yourself, but you also have a chance to help support the show.